All right, g'day guys. Welcome back to Stat Chat Sports. You've got Steve and Tazza here, looking at week 15 of the Premier League, in particular the game of the week. Every week we look at one fixture and highlight that. This weekend is no different. We've got Chelsea versus Arsenal at Stamford Bridge, first versus sixth, Arteta versus Conte. It's going to be a fruitful evening.
Yeah, we've obviously got Arsenal who are just really trouncing all before them. Obviously, with the one loss this season, but off the back of a 5-0 win against Nottingham Forest, they're raring, they're humming. Chelsea, on the other hand, as we've talked about in our previous video, are kind of just spluttering a little bit. It's the Potter project is, it's going to take time. It'll be given time, but it probably hasn't got off to the perfect start that they were looking for. Winless in their last three, but this is at Stamford Bridge. So who knows? I mean, I'm probably going to look at Arsenal. They have the recent win, even at Stamford Bridge. Mm. And this is a different Arsenal to last season too. They're just a machine at the moment. I keep trying to find reasons why they can't challenge City for the title. I'm not going to say that they're right at the same level, but they're at this point, they're the nearest challenger. And for that reason, I probably expect them to get the 3 points again.
Yeah, I agree. I think it's hard to look past Arsenal in any fixture at this point in time, as to not say that they're the outright favourites to win that game. So, you know, yeah, like you mentioned, they won last season 4-2 at Stamford Bridge. but, you know, it's been relatively evenly spread, I suppose, in the last five, two wins for both sides and a draw. So not a lot to separate the two sides there. But again, as you touched on, this is a different Arsenal side this season. And in the same vein, this is a different Chelsea side, at least at the start of this season. So, you know, you're looking at an Arsenal side who's leagues above where they've been in recent years. So, you know, I can't see why, you know, they couldn't get the job done here. This could still present a problem for them. The way that Chelsea set up and they play it, somewhat similar to you know, Manchester United, who that's their only loss this season, comes against a side that sort of doesn't mind sitting back and catching you on the counter attack. And if Chelsea can do it properly, they can cause some trouble here. But if they don't do it properly, then we'll see what happened in the North London derby against Tottenham, where Arsenal will just remain in possession and remain on top and just keep on battering you and wilting you away until they eventually make the breakthrough and get one, get two, get three, and the game's done. But yeah, I think this is Arsenal's to lose, really. You know, they can't afford really any slip up. City, you know, have made the ground on them to some degree. It's now only 2 points the difference. So they can't really afford to have a slip up here if they want to hold on to that top spot this week. But I think I can see them getting it done somewhere along the lines of a 3-1. Arsenal have been solid defensively, but I think Chelsea have the capabilities to catch them on that counter-attack, albeit to little to no effect, really, on the outcome of the game.
Yeah, point at Arsenal's probably even spread of goals, too. I mean, they've got multiple threats to get the job done. They're not relying on one guy. I mean, got Jesus on 5, Martinelli on 5, Saka on 4. So they've got a very even contribution from their attackers. And yeah, I mean, it's that kind of even spread that I think Chelsea are going to find hard to lock down. When one pops up, or when one's down, another one's going to pop up.
And they can all provide for each other too. Jesus and Saka both got 5 assists between the two.
Yeah. And I think it's a fluid unit. And that's why they're not reliant on a central figure in that attack, in that front three. It's completely, it's flexible. And I think that's what gives them the edge, especially in this fixture.
Yeah, so I think it's a foregone conclusion. You know, I'm not necessarily writing Chelsea off here, but at the same time, I kind of am. You know, it has the potential to be close, but it also has the potential for, an Arsenal runaway if they get a firm foothold in the game. Maybe grab an early goal. It'll force Chelsea to sort of come out of their shell a little bit. And the way that Arsenal have been playing so far, their fluency up front and the control in the midfield, even the likes of Granit Xhaka is in probably the form of his life at the moment, in just goal scoring as well, which, you know, he's popped up with a couple so far this season. They've literally got the goals everywhere, whereas you don't really have that on the side of Chelsea.
Now, Granit Xhaka's a guy who really copped it for the last few years.
Rightly so.
In the infant... What's that?
Rightly so.
Yeah, in the infancy of Arteta, I mean, he was atrocious on some levels, many levels, but all the credit to him because he's rejuvenated himself and got himself as a crucial part of a tight unit, and yeah, seeing results.
Let us know your thoughts and below down in the comments below who you think will win this one. If you're an Arsenal or a Chelsea fan, let us know. I think it's going to be a good one overall, but I think, you know, between the two of us, we firmly agree that Arsenal will take the points. All right, Taz, to round it off, it's time for the unpopular opinion segment. We don't mind doing these and running through a couple of unpopular opinions. We are still running through a few of our own that we're coming up with mostly on the fly. But it's not hard to come up with an unpopular opinion at times. But did you want to kick us off with yours today?
Yeah, I'm not 100% sure how unpopular it is, because I think in the recent weeks we are seeing that this might be more of a case of actually being a popular opinion. But Gini Wijnaldum is the most underrated player of the Klopp era at Liverpool.
Oh, yeah. Yeah. Look, when he left during a time where obviously he's going to look back at it and regret it. You know, they got a league title. Wait, was he part of the league title winning side? I think he was, wasn't he?
Yeah.
So he left
18,
after
19?
That. Yeah. Okay. So to be fair to him, he hasn't missed out on a great deal when he left, but at the same time, he also hasn't done a great deal since he left. But yeah, the importance of Wijnaldum in that midfield, he was the engine room in that team. You know, there's nobody now who's filled his boots since he's left that has the engine like him that will just get up and down, run, get involved in the attack, get involved in the defense, do all the dirty work in the middle. And I think he was a large part and a large piece of the puzzle for Klopp and Liverpool's success as it is anyway. And, you know, I put it their midfield down to the reason why they're struggling so badly anyway. And you can look at it and say that Wijnaldum is clearly a missing piece of that puzzle. It's easy for people to point out Sadio Mane at the top too, but you know, we never replaced a player like Gini Wijnaldum. We sold Wijnaldum and brought in Thiago, completely different player. You know, he's not that player in the engine room that'll do the dirty work for you. Thiago's there to, you know, add a bit more flair and finesse into the midfield, which would have worked alongside a player like Wijnaldum. But the fact that he's gone, you know, it changes the dynamic. So I loved Gini Wijnaldum when he was at the club. He did a lot, you know, coming from Newcastle. You know, it was a bit of an eyebrow raiser, I suppose, at the time of the signing. But, you know, just like many of the signings under Klopp, and much like, you know, Wijnaldum in particular, that sort of outside of the box player, I suppose, he turns him into superstar, and his time at Liverpool was amazing. And yeah, he's been difficult to replace. So to call him the most underrated player, yeah, I could agree. Or maybe underappreciated, potentially.
Underappreciated is probably a good word.
Yeah, because, you know, the work that he does, you know, he's not getting all the goals, or he's not making all the, you know, the last ditch tackles, or obviously the saves he's not a keeper or anything like that. But yeah, you know, he's that kind of player that the work that he does sort of goes a bit unnoticed.
Yeah, and you pointed to Liverpool's midfield being their problem. I mean, when Wijnaldum was sold, he left on a free, didn't he?
Yeah, I think he was, yeah.
I think he signed at PSG for a free. Yeah, they replaced him with Thiago, and Thiago was never going to be. Thiago's been great. He's had flashes of brilliance, but he didn't have the consistency that Wijnaldum did. And that, I don't think that's Thiago's fault. I think it's the system's fault. The system never changed completely for him. Mm. It was always still the heavy metal press that Jurgen Klopp has probably only just shifted away from a little bit.
Mm.
He's decided to play with a little more, I wouldn't say finesse, but it's not the complete same system we've seen for the last 7 years of Klopp's reign. But yeah, I think this recent dip in form is showing just how crucial Wijnaldum was. Never needed to be the star, but just needed to be a gut runner, be in the right place at the right time. And a lot of people knocked Liverpool for their lack of goals, but lack of goals in midfield. They scored plenty of goals, but I don't think anyone is bemoaning that at the moment. I mean, the midfield wasn't there to score goals. We had plenty of attackers who could do that job. We just needed to hold that possession to be able to put it, to give them the chances, and that's just not happening anymore.
What was mine again? Oh yeah, okay, yep.
Sorry.
That's all right. All right, Tazza, I'm revisiting someone we've spoken about in our video earlier on in the week, Miguel Amarón. He's a top three player in the Premier League at the moment. I'd say behind only Erling Haaland and probably Kevin De Bruyne.
Yeah. When you said top three, they're the other two players I had, Haaland and De Bruyne. Past that, yeah, it's a bit of a mix. I mean, Harry Kane's record goes unnoticed because of Haaland. He's obviously, I think he's on 9 goals.
10.
10? Yeah, so he's hitting double figures already. But, I mean, it's Harry Kane, so that's expected.
Yeah.
He'll hit 20 just about every year.
Mm.
Yeah, look, on current form, I think he's right up there. 6 goals in 6 games. You'd be, I think, only Erling Haaland would probably be able to match that.
Yeah.
So why couldn't he be top three on current form? It's an odd pick on the face of it.
Mm.
But when you look a bit deeper, I don't think it's awful. I think it probably has merit.
Yeah, and when you look at just the, you know, the importance of him in particular to Newcastle currently, you know, there are definitely some other players which you can, you know, make arguments for. I think you could make an argument for Saka for Arsenal, purely based, you know, his goals and assist contributions as well. Obviously Harry Kane, like you mentioned, but I just, you know, as someone out of the box, and someone who probably doesn't get the recognition that he probably deserves at present, I think he deserves to be, you know, his name deserves to be in there. And if he continues on the form that he'll be, you know, he's not gonna win the Golden Boot. He's not gonna outscore Erling Haaland. No one is, you know, he hasn't registered a single assist yet. So he's not gonna get that part of the accolade. But, you know, at the end of the season, if he continues on the way he is, and then obviously depends on sort of where Newcastle finish, if they finish in the top four or, you know, maybe just outside and still get Europa, you know, you'll look at him and say, you know, this guy's the reason why this has happened. And for someone different and for a side like Newcastle, you know, I think he absolutely deserves to be in there and have his name around in amongst the superstars.
Yeah, if you're looking outside the top six for a guy who's probably pushing that top three or in it, apart from Erling Haaland and Kevin De Bruyne, he's your man. Because his form is sensational. And yeah, along with Callum Wilson, who's also scoring quite well, he's, yeah, a good reason why Newcastle are where they are.
All right, well, we're going to wrap it up there. Let us know your thoughts about anything spoken about today in the comments below. If you've got any of your own unpopular opinions, leave them in the comments so we can bring them up on future podcasts. But yeah, Tazza, that's going to wrap us up. Thanks for joining us, mate. If anyone is new around here and you enjoyed the videos, give them a like and a subscribe if you are new. And thanks for joining us as always. We'll see you in the next one. Cheers.